The subcommittee is meeting today to hear testimony on the following oversight topic: the need for the establishment of a Puerto Rican Financial Stability and Economic Growth Authority. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at hearings are limited to the chairman, the ranking minority member, and vice chairman, and designee of the ranking member. This will allow us to hear from the witnesses sooner and help members keep to their schedules. Therefore, I ask the unanimous consent that all members' opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted to the subcommittee clerk by 5 p.m. today, and the close of the hearing, whichever comes first, hearing no objections so ordered. I also ask the unanimous consent that the gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Goodell, and the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Gartillas, the gentleman from Idaho, Mr. Labrador, the gentleman from New York, Mr. Serrano, and the gentlewoman from New York, Mrs. Valaquez, be allowed to join us on the dais to be recognized and participate in today's hearing, hearing no objections so ordered. The Subcommittee on Indian and Insular Affairs, Alaska Natives meets today again, as I mentioned, to need the establishment of a Puerto Rican Financial Stability and Economic Growth Authority. The crisis has gripped the island of Puerto Rico. The Obama administration, congressional Democrats, the governor of Puerto Rico, and their local territorial legislature, they are all correct, it is a crisis. In light of that, Republicans on this committee are taking extra precaution to consider all the causes of this crisis to produce a comprehensive solution to a very complex problem. Some on the other side of this dais would have us believe that the solution to a crisis is simply providing Puerto Rico government tools to restructure their enormous debt by using Chapter 9 of the Bankruptcy Code. I would remind everyone here that Chapter 9 is a process, not a solution. Furthermore, the claim that the island miseries will be washed away by extending their government use of Chapter 9, I believe, is short-sighted and naive, to say the least. What we're able to determine, despite the lack of access to accurate financial audits of the government of Puerto Rico, is that cramming down debt of this stage will only hurt the problems concerning their current liquidity and access to the financial markets. But the real determinant of offering short-sighted solution would ignore the real causes of the problem: seeped in poor budgeting standards, overbloated government agencies, lack of fiscal transparency and accountability, and severe lack of credibility on the municipal bond markets. The key root causes of the economic crisis, coupled with astronomical debt, are producing further deterioration of essential services being provided to the populace. In order for the island to begin to truly recover from this dire situation, it needs to be actually reforms within the island. The Americans living in Puerto Rico, these are all Americans, are demanding strong leadership, capable of making necessary structural reforms, the hard choices to get the economy growing again and employment opportunities back. They deserve nothing less than the benefits that come with living within the United States, namely accountability in government, responsibility in fiscal management, and opportunities to create, innovate, and thrive with a tolerable business climate. A climate where energy prices are manageable and regulations do not hinder the ability of economic growth. If Puerto Rico is capable or is incapable or unwilling to provide these opportunities for these Americans, then the federal government has a responsibility to assist the island and help provide these opportunities that are lacking and desperately needed. To quote Speaker Ryan, who put so eloquently in his address last December, what government is supposed to do is to create an environment where the individual can thrive and communities can bloom. In other words, government makes things possible, but the people make them happen. Americans calling the territory home deserve nothing less. The opportunity to recover from this crisis with strong leadership and assistance from the federal government is the end solution we're here in this committee and aiming to provide. We would hope our colleagues and on the other side of the aisle heed our call for developing a real, comprehensive, meaningful solution to present the President. We want to put Puerto Rico in a sustainable path towards full-term recovery and see this island thrive and prosper the next 100 years and beyond. I would say one thing on my behalf: if we'd done what I wanted to do 15 years ago, we wouldn't be in this mess. If we'd been made Puerto Rico a state, which they wanted to do, but Congress did not act. And I always will blame Congress for that. This is a territory that should be a state, and I've been very partisan in that. Not Republican or Democrat, but because I believe in it. I'll also suggest respectfully that this is a very difficult time for me, because I'm very strong on Puerto Rico. And we do, you do, and we do have a financial crisis. And we're here today to try to solve that crisis. We'd like to find out from the witnesses what they would suggest. And in doing so, maybe we can have these Americans that put their lives on the line every day like every other American be recognized. We have neglected for over 100 years a territory that should be a state. We've neglected Main America and this Congress. And I'll say shame on us. And with that, I recognize the minority member.
Thank you, Chairman Yeo. Following this hearing, the Natural Resources Committee will craft legislation on Puerto Rico. To become law, the bill must be bipartisan and balanced. That means we're either going to pass a good bill or no bill at all. If no bill is enacted, the already grave situation in Puerto Rico will get worse. That would not be in the national interest, in the interest of my constituents, or in the interest of Puerto Rico's creditors, many of whom are also my constituents. The drafting process should be informed by two bills that Congress enacted for Washington, D.C. in 1995 and 1997, which are best viewed as a single legislative package. D.C. and Puerto Rico are different in material respects, so the D.C. package should guide, but not dictate, the Puerto Rico bill. The legislation should be holistic, containing three elements. First, the Puerto Rico government has a record of fiscal mismanagement. We must acknowledge this painful fact, vow to do better for our constituents, and accept some temporary assistance along the way. As I have previously stated, I would support the creation of an independent board to approve the Puerto Rico government's financial plan and annual budgets, to confirm that the Puerto Rico government's government adheres to both throughout the fiscal year, and to ensure the publication of accurate and timely financial information. A board can serve as a bridge to a brighter future, enabling the Puerto Rico government to perform more effectively and regain access to the financial markets. The DC board was successful in instilling fiscal discipline only because it had buy-in from local government, business, and labor leaders. To achieve similar support, the Puerto Rico board must be carefully calibrated. As a territory, Puerto Rico has no democracy at the national level. If a bill seeks to extinguish our democracy at the local level, I will do everything in my power to defeat it. Second, the Puerto Rico government must restructure its bonded debt. I say this with regret. Individuals and institutions loaned Puerto Rico money, and Puerto Rico promised to pay them with interest. So you will never hear me vilify creditors. However, while bond-issuing entities in Puerto Rico can pay some of their debts, they cannot pay all of their debts under the current terms and conditions without compromising quality of life and economic growth in the territory to an unacceptable degree. This assertion should not be subject to reasonable dispute. Unlike the states, Puerto Rico has no authority under federal law to restructure debt. There is a consensus among objective observers that Congress should grant Puerto Rico such authority, which would cost taxpayers nothing. I would be open to a provision that requires the oversight board to appoint a neutral third party to mediate consensual debt restructuring negotiations between bond-issuing entities in Puerto Rico and their creditors in order to reach agreements that restructure Puerto Rico's debt to a sustainable level, provide fair treatment to creditors, and can be confirmed and enforced by a federal court. When it comes to restructuring authority, I will be flexible regarding the means to the end, but not the end itself. Finally, the legislation should provide Puerto Rico with more state-like treatment under federal programs, because decades of neglect from Washington is the root cause of the territory's economic, fiscal, and migration problems. I join Chairman Young's statement. Puerto Rico should have been treated equally long time ago. Long time ago, Puerto Rico should have joined this union. So when we ask for state-like treatment, this is not charity or a bailout. This is about fundamental justice. If Puerto Rico were a state, the problems we confront today would not exist, at least not in such severe form. Puerto Rico would have voting representatives in Congress to defend its interests, parity under all federal programs, and access to Chapter 9 of the Federal Bankruptcy Code. Island leaders would not have to come, hat in hand, imploring Congress to grant Puerto Rico rights and powers that every state takes for granted. More equitable treatment is consistent with precedent. The legislative package for DC has provided the capital city with billions of dollars in fundings and savings. The forthcoming bill cannot eliminate every inequality Puerto Rico faces, because only statehood could accomplish that, but it should make a real effort to mitigate certain disparities. Let me close with an appeal to my colleagues. Before you try to come up with all sorts of clever and convoluted ways to respond to the crisis in Puerto Rico, you should simply extend to the territory those federal programs and policies that have already proven effective in the states that you represent. Resist the urge to experiment with my constituents' lives. Equality is the best policy. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you for a very good statement, echoing my thoughts. You're a smart member of this committee. We'll start with Mr. Mayor. And welcome, by the way, Mr. Mayor. I thought you were a great mayor. I don't know what your constituents thought, but I thought you were, so you may proceed. And I'm a little bit lenient, but I try to keep the 5 minutes. If you're being very eloquent, I'll let you extend it a little bit. That's for the rest of the members of this committee, too. But it's usually 5 minutes. You watch that little thing, it'll tell you what to do. Mr. Mayor, you're up. Mr. Williams.
Well, first of all, Mr. Chairman, thank you for your generosity and your kind comments. And on that note, I probably should leave, but I will also thank the members of the subcommittee for inviting me today to testify on this important matter. And I want to highlight just a few central points in my written testimony and be as brief as possible in deference to the other speakers and the members of the committee. I benefit from my experience today talking to you as CFO of a congressionally created entity that oversaw the fiscal recovery of our nation's capital. And recognizing that every situation is different, I believe the time has come to explore the creation by Congress of an entity that can facilitate returning Puerto Rico to a position of sustained financial stability, to create, as the speaker would say, an environment of success that induces investment. For the reasons I'll address, I support the creation of such an entity with authorities and responsibilities that would aid and empower the Commonwealth to realize fiscal stability and economic growth. Let me start by initially observing that any solution to Puerto Rico's fiscal challenges requires that this entity, which the subcommittee is considering, be created to give focused attention to how best to resolve the island's myriad expected and substantial bond defaults. Unquestionably, the extent of impending defaults and the seemingly increasing inability of the Commonwealth to meet these obligations warrants an independent entity to be put in a position to help find a workable and fair solution acceptable not only to the people of Puerto Rico, but also to the creditors. And these are not only the bondholders, but other creditors in terms of pensioners who are owed over $70 billion. And the fact that these problems have been subject of considerable and increasing focus for more than 2 years, with no real signs that the various constituencies are coming to common ground, to me further underscores the need for a fresh and independent team of neutrals with expertise in addressing governmental financial distress to be empaneled to both help develop sustainable solutions and to forge trust and build cooperation among the competing factions. But let me be clear, I don't take sides about whether any such bondholder concessions are really needed or how much, or for that matter, who other than bondholders might also be expected to participate in making concessions to bring budgets into balance now and into the foreseeable future. Indeed, until the entity we suggest undertakes much of what will be tasked, the extent of any required concessions can't be known. When you have a series of unaudited opinions, when you have a situation of great financial uncertainty, I think it makes sense to get the financial house in order get financial reporting in order, get a dashboard in place before decisions can be made. Hence, what I believe is simply that an independent group of financially sophisticated people who collectively bring a combination of government efficiency and financial distress expertise can play a critical and disciplined role in first developing a set of financial and operating strategies, and then, hopefully by achieving consensus among disparate constituencies, implement these strategies to ensure that the Puerto Rican government will be fiscally sound and the island's economy once again is growing and vibrant. Turning then to the wisdom of also tasking the contemplated entity with the additional goal of fostering the island's economic growth, I don't think anyone can take issue with the view that it would be most desirable if Puerto Rico could increase its tax base through new inbound investments by mainland companies and plants in island operations, thereby producing new taxable income and expanding the workforce. Utilizing that approach to achieving revenue improvement would be far preferable means to ameliorate the distress we're talking about than simply cramming down debt or cramming down liabilities to any creditor. To provide the most optimistic environment for growing Puerto Rico's economy, it is essential that the Commonwealth be seen as fulfilling as much of its debt obligations as possible, and that's why I'm so pleased that the committee has recognized that one of the key functions of the contemplated authority should be to look at tangible ways for the island, to the fullest extent possible, grow out of its debt problems through stimulated economic expansion and increased tax revenues. This committee's focus on economic expansion, in my view, can also demonstrate to the people the commitment of Congress to assist the island in achieving long-term financial stability predicated not only on finding efficiencies in the delivery of their government services, but at least equally so on the healthier and growing economy that fosters new well-paying private sector jobs. Hearkening further to my DC experience, the subcommittee's apparent legislative approach appears quite similar to the motivation behind creating an independent authority for Washington, namely, to provide meaningful guidance to all affected constituencies to help develop and fashion innovative approaches and to foster cooperation among all affected constituencies. Like the DC approach, the focus of this entity should certainly be forward-looking and not to point blame on anyone and who shot John and all that, but forward-looking, solving the problem, enacting a vision based on the input from all the different parties. The problems presented by Puerto Rico's current financial challenges are complex, and the goal of Congress, I believe, if it pursues the authority's creation, should be to provide Puerto Rico with the best means available to help remedy the fiscal distress as soon as possible, and in so doing, to deliver the kind of economic expansion and settled expectations that I'm talking about. Now, since my time is rapidly dwindling away, I want to focus on several additional key points regarding my views about the structure of this entity. One, I believe the Congress should keep the composition of the authority limited number. I think 5, but no more than 7 members would achieve the right balance. 2, I strongly advocate that the authority appoint a CFO or a financial executive to be involved in both the coordination of the authority's activities, but also to work day-to-day with the public, with the Commonwealth's administration and its legislature to create reliable budgets and long-term financial plans, to work with the government of Puerto Rico on creating reliable revenue estimates, reliable expenditure forecasts, and to give this entity, based on that cooperation, and sometimes notwithstanding that cooperation, the approval authority over these budgets and financial plans. Likewise, Congress should ensure that the authority's members will be prepared to commit to a significant and sustained workload for a considerable period. They will also need to retain a staff of financial and legal professionals to work at their direction in both conceiving and effectuating various initiatives. As I said, the financial condition presented today is very complex. There are an array of challenges, and I think nothing short of a fully committed effort can be expected to accomplish what Congress envisions.
Mr. Mayor, you're 2 minutes and 35 minutes.
Okay.
That was a little bit, but good. You close.
One final thing. The powers and authorities that Congress vests in the authority need to be sufficient to get the job done once and for all. And so while, for example, in the district, there were two acts that the ranking member recollects were part of our recovery, as much as possible, if the work can all be done at one time, I think we'll be that much farther down the road to creating the kind of environment of success, the settled expectations that will begin to bring back the investment to the island and create the kind of economic recovery that we're all seeking for the people there. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for great testimony, Mr. Carlos Garcia.
Good morning, Chairman Young, Resident Commissioner Pierluisi, other distinguished members of this committee, and all that have in the best interest of Puerto Rico. My name is Carlos Garcia. I was the Chairman, President, and CEO of the Government Development Bank for Puerto Rico from January 2009 to March 11. And in addition, I was appointed as Chairman of the Puerto Rico Fiscal Restructuring and Stabilization Board, a local fiscal control board created by law on March of 2009 with a comprehensive and joint-minded to address a complex fiscal emergency created through many years of fiscal imbalances, and in my opinion, the negative tailed economic effect of the decision to repeal Section 936, which provided a manufacturing center for the world in Puerto Rico, and aggravated by Puerto Rico's failure to develop an alternative economic plan. Second task was to ensure the continuation of essential services to the people of Puerto Rico and to safeguard Puerto Rico's credit rating. The local control board acted swiftly by creating and executing a fiscal stabilization plan. It executed this plan with transparency to all Puerto Rico stakeholders, including a creation of a funded program to mitigate the socioeconomic effects of its mandates. It was a very difficult and unpopular job, not void of controversy, but by 2011, the swift actions of the local board, the governor of Puerto Rico, the legislature, and its cabinet provided a fiscal stabilization, including a double-digit reduction in government expenses, two straight years of surpassed government budgeted revenues, the timely delivery of financial statements, and an unparalleled reduction of the fiscal deficit. It reestablished the access to the municipal market, and also the first credit rating upgrades and the highest credit investment grade ratings in almost three decades, and started the beginning of an economic stabilization. The local control board was composed of a team of five cabinet level officials with ministerial responsibilities over fiscal oversight, government funding, revenue, expenditure, labor policy, and economic development. The work of the control board was comprehensive and effective, documented in the local control board report to the Puerto Rico legislator, dated March 11th, which is attached to my testimony. The control board gave Puerto Rico a centralized implementation and decision-making arm to self-adjust itself out of its pre-2009 fiscal crisis. It only had a two-year mandate, which in my belief was too short. The local board did not have powers to eliminate or consolidate government agencies or to implement structural, economic, labor, or tax measures, which was a shortcoming. After the local control board disbanded in 2011, the strength of its centralized programs as well as its implementation arm disappeared. What happened after the local control board disappeared is painfully known to today to all of us, as many of these things could have been averted. But the question is, how can Puerto Rico break out of this treacherous downward spiral, and what can Congress do? In my opinion, it is imperative to create a long-term fiscal and economic authority to address holistically and comprehensively all of Puerto Rico issues, fiscal, economic, and social, once and for all, in a credible, sensible, consistent, and swift manner. At this stage, in my opinion, the probability of success is only viable with the creation of a federally mandated Puerto Rico fiscal and economic authority enacted by Congress, but with strong local participation. The authority should be provided the powers and tools to implement structural reforms of the government of Puerto Rico and its agencies, require the prior approval by the authority of all governmental budgets, additional indebtedness, capital expenditures, and employment level, provide for a complete overhaul of Puerto Rico's accounting, budgeting, payroll, information, and other control system, as well as its associated processes, and manage the restructuring and renegotiation process of all of Puerto Rico's obligations under a clear framework establishing the authority's Federal Enabling Act based on generally acceptable public debt restructuring principles. There is no one-size-fits-all solution considering that Puerto Rico has roughly 20 issuers. The challenges are further compounded by the diversity of creditors that range from sophisticated institutional investors to mom and pops, The proposed framework should provide a speedy, predictable, and orderly process that protects assets, respects creditors' rights, but also recognizes that underlying all the formal debts, there are social obligations with respect to pensions, education, and health programs. The authority, as a single point of resolution, should arguably be better equipped by the composition of its governing board to balance these equities than the bankruptcy process or other courts. As well, it is critical to attend the issues of the economy of Puerto Rico by creating jobs and generating regional activity. Attached to my testimony is a white paper that outlines a one-time temporary proposal that is revenue neutral to U.S. taxpayers to jumpstart the economic recovery of Puerto Rico by permitting U.S. corporations holding funds outside of the U.S. to repatriate a limited amount of those funds under the requirement that at least 50% of those funds are invested in activities in Puerto Rico. My last recommendation is for U.S. Congress to immediately confirm the current financial situation and deficit of the government of Puerto Rico via the Congressional Budget Office and require the government of Puerto Rico to issue promptly independent audited financial statements and provide monthly reporting information. One cannot fix what one cannot measure or monitor. I thank you for the privilege and honor to address you today and will gladly answer any questions on my testimony. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Garcia. We have Professor Simon Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm a professor at MIT's Sloan School of Management. I've worked on economic crises around the world for 30 years. In 2007, 2008, I was the chief economist of the International Monetary Fund. And I would like to make three points. First of all, Mr. Chairman, I think you put your finger on the key issue already, which is if Puerto Rico were a state or had been allowed to become a state, we would not be here today. The safety mechanisms, the automatic stabilizers that states have in the United States, while no doubt not perfect, are not available to Puerto Rico. As a result, triggered in part by the economic crisis and other circumstances that you also identified, when Puerto Rico started downhill, there's not enough force to pull it back up. And now we face what is, I'm afraid, an extremely serious debt crisis. And I would emphasize, Mr. Chairman, one very important compounding factor, which we, I believe, have never seen to this extent in any other crisis around the world, certainly, which is migration. This is 3.5 million U.S. citizens. They will leave. And particularly the people who leave are the people who pay taxes. If the solution, and I don't believe it is what we're discussing today, but if the solution is austerity, wage cuts, benefits cuts, they will leave. They will come to the United States, and they will take advantage, for example, of the earned income tax credit, which is a very good anti-poverty and pro-employment participation scheme that's available to everyone who lives in the 50 states, but not to people in Puerto Rico. So, in that context, I would emphasize, and I think I'm agreeing with the two previous witnesses, but I would emphasize slightly these points. First of all, yes, a growth authority is a good idea under these circumstances. And yes, audited financials and an understanding of exactly the situation today and realistic projections, of course, that's absolutely a requirement. And that's always, of course, what every country in crisis needs. But you have very little time. This is a serious crisis that has been growing for a long period, as you're identified, Mr. Chairman. But it is this year, and I think Speaker Ryan is exactly right to emphasize that we need a plan. You need to act on legislation by the end of March. And if you wait, the crisis will become considerably worse. More people will leave. The tax base will further disintegrate, and the creditors will get even less. So everyone loses in that situation. The second point I would make is I want to agree completely with Resident Commissioner Pierluisi on the issue of local democracy. Again, the experience around the world is that when measures are taken under these difficult circumstances, under such difficult circumstances, if people feel that they are imposed from the outside, if local democracy is extinguished or felt to be extinguished, you do not have good outcomes. You have to have buy-in, and I think this is what Mr. Garcia was saying, and as a former constituent of Mr. Williams, I would say there was buy-in, and I would say he did a great job with the support of the local population. And that's what you need to aim for in Puerto Rico. It's not easy, but I think there is a way forward, as the resident commissioner has identified. The third point is of course, the most sensitive and perhaps the most emotional today, which is the debt and the extent to which restructuring is needed and what kind of debt needs to be restructured. You know, I think that the I think it's uncontroversial, but we'll see, that the U.S. government and Congress sits relative to Puerto Rico very much as a state sits relative to a city in other parts of the United States, in the 50 states. And you have the ability, the responsibility, and absolutely the legal authority to create an to create a board or a growth authority that has the ability to restructure the debt and has the ability potentially, obviously a very important decision to be made by Congress, to potentially restructure all of the debt that has been issued by Puerto Rico. Now, obviously, not all creditors are the same. Not all creditors have the same seniority. There are different terms and different contracts. I really hope that a voluntary debt exchange can be agreed to. But again, the experience around the world is that when you have complex set of claims, as in Puerto Rico, and different kinds of creditors, they almost always have, let's say, overly optimistic expectations about how much they can get if they wait and if they delay and if they don't agree to a voluntary exchange. So I think that you really must create, in the context of an authority that has this investigative ability, it has the oversight ability, it does not extinguish democracy, that authority working hopefully with the established court system, which I think is very strong on many of these issues, must have the ability to restructure potentially all of the debt that has been issued by Puerto Rico. Thank you very much.
I hope we have the intelligence to call upon us witnesses to help us write a piece of legislation, because I can guarantee if we write it by ourselves, we'll screw it up. You know. So, Mr. Eric LeConte, thank you.
I truly appreciate your opening comments in terms of framing the crisis and the situation that we're dealing with. I also want to thank the previous panelists and also certainly identify my remarks with Professor Simon Johnson's, who I think gave a very good assessment of the needs and the situation. I'm the executive director of Jubilee USA, and we represent national religious bodies, congregations, and institutions. Our founders and members in the United States range
from... Eric, would you just see... You with the gray hair, would you quit bobbing around this bothering when people are testifying? I don't care. I would say when someone testifies, and I don't like distractions. Go ahead, Eric.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jubilee USA represents groups that range from our founders and members that include the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops to American Jewish World Service to most of the national Protestant denominations. We represent 550 faith communities across our great country, and we focus on how the most vulnerable are impacted by global issues such as trade, debt, corruption, and taxes. We've worked with Congress and successive administrations on global debt issues for almost 20 years. Because of the agreements we've achieved together, our financial system is more responsible, more transparent, and developing countries have seen over $130 billion in debt relief to build schools and medical centers around the world. It's thanks to President George W. Bush that in 2005, the cornerstone of U.S. bipartisan policy on debt restructuring and financial accountability was laid, the Multilateral Debt Relief Initiative. Not only did this legislation enable innovative financing for countries who need it to deal with poor populations, it also set standards around government accountability and public budget transparency. In Puerto Rico in particular, we partner with the religious leaders representing more than 95% of the island's population. The leaders include the Catholic Archbishop of San Juan and the head of Puerto Rico's Bible Society. Along with my testimony, I submit an August statement signed by all of Puerto Rico's major religious leaders asking Congress to take action regarding the Congress in Puerto Rico. I also submit a letter from Archbishop Wenske on behalf of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops urging Congress to pass bankruptcy protection for the indebted territory. From a religious perspective, we recognize, as you laid out, Chairman Young, that this is simply not only a debt crisis, this is a humanitarian crisis. Consider that nearly 50% of Puerto Rico's people live in poverty. 50% of Puerto Rico's children live in homes that receive some form of welfare benefits. 80% of Puerto Rico's children live in high poverty areas. Because pension accounts have been used to pay the debt, government pensions may not have enough funds to meet their obligations by 2020. The current employment rate in Puerto Rico is over 12%, and over the past decade, 10% of the population has left for the U.S. mainland in search of work. Like our religious partners on the island, we pray for two things. First, long-term solutions to Puerto Rico's economic troubles that address the underlying problems that led to this mess in the first place. Second, immediate measures to help Puerto Rico's people who are suffering right now. This committee has a very important role to play in both the short term and long term. In the short term, the reality is Puerto Rico can't cut its way out of this crisis. It can't tax its way out of this crisis. There is no path to economic growth for Puerto Rico that doesn't start with debt restructuring. Self-imposed austerity in Puerto Rico is already proving harmful and counterproductive. Funding for law enforcement has dropped 3 years in a row. Special education teachers are no longer being paid, directly harming some of the most vulnerable kids on the island. 200 schools have closed. Puerto Rico cut its health spending by $42 million this year. This takes place as the Zika virus now spreads in Puerto Rico. These types of measures push more people on the island to leave for the U.S. mainland, which further erodes Puerto Rico's tax base. It's a cycle that's only getting worse. The good news is that we can solve this crisis in ways that promote economic growth and reduce child poverty. A step in this direction is enacting bankruptcy protection for Puerto Rico, the same type of protection U.S. municipalities have access to. We applaud the efforts of Representatives Duffy and Pierluisi for introducing bankruptcy legislation. We're very grateful to Speaker Ryan for setting a timeline for action. Our opposition to austerity should not be confused with opposition to reform. At the root of today's hearing lies the questions: how do we prevent future debt crises in Puerto Rico, and how do we ensure greater accountability from Puerto Rico's government? Part of the answer to this question is that through an orderly debt restructuring process, we bring the debt back to sustainable, payable levels. However, this committee is concerned also with how there needs to be more accountability from Puerto Rico's government itself. From the beginning of this crisis, Jubilee USA and its religious partners in Puerto Rico called for increased budget transparency and accountability in the island's government. We want more citizens' participation in economic decision-making, policies that we've pursued successfully on other heavily indebted Caribbean islands and countries around the world. To this end, we are pleased that the Puerto Rico Audit Commission has begun its work. We support Congress's action to make available Treasury's Office of Technical Assistance. This particular action that you all enacted with the omnibus can help Puerto Rico keep its debt stock in order, become more accountable to its citizens, and raise revenues. This action can show powerful results. I think in closing, in terms of the question of the Financial Control Board that this committee is looking at today, we've seen this type of fiscal authority utilized during other economic crises in the United States. In terms of Puerto Rico, the White House has acknowledged the need for some authority, and Representative Duffy's legislation details how one would be constructed. As Congress looks to pass bankruptcy and greater accountability provisions, any control board must look at how Puerto Rico is represented in the process. If Congress passes bankruptcy protection with a control board, Congress should ensure that such a control board is co-chaired by appointments from the federal government and the government of Puerto Rico. Local democracy must be respected. In the long term, we believe the island needs reforms that ensure Puerto Rico economy serves its people. Debt restructuring to allow for economic growth and accountability measures to stave corruption. 3.5 million Americans face a humanitarian crisis. We look forward to working with the committee to find a solution to end the crisis, promote economic growth, and ensure greater transparency. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Meyer, you're last, but I'm not gonna say what's your best yet. We'll see what happens.
Thank you, Chairman Young, and thank you, Member Ruiz, and the members of the subcommittee for inviting me to testify today. My name is Thomas Moores Mayer, and I represent mutual funds managed by Franklin Advisors and Oppenheimer Funds that collectively own $10 billion of Puerto Rico debt securities. We think we are the largest creditors of the island. And we invest on behalf of hundreds of thousands of individual investors. Franklin and Oppenheimer collectively have over 600,000 shareholders in their municipal bond funds. And municipal bond investors, ladies and gentlemen, they are individuals. Most Puerto Rican debt is held by individuals, including, as Representative Pierluisi acknowledged, Puerto Ricans themselves, both on and off island. And these investors, they are mostly over 65, and they mostly have income of less than $100,000 a year. They are not vulture funds. They are your friends and neighbors. And they are not the problem. We believe that a substantial amount of the problem, perhaps all the problem, we don't know, as the chairman indicated, is found in misgovernment and not in investment. The Commonwealth itself fails to collect $2.5 billion a year in taxes that its own consultant says it has the ability to collect. At the governmental corporation level, the electric company, PREPA, with which I'm quite familiar, it sells power to government corporations that don't pay. It pays an annual salary to employees for as little as 9 months' work, and it's run by 200 political appointees. A bipartisan authority, a strong authority, can address these problems. We would urge that this authority be appointed by the President, confirmed by the Senate, and acceptable, and it must be acceptable to Puerto Rico. And we believe the authority should have the power to address the problems that need to be addressed, most particularly the power of the purse. Access to federal funds should be conditioned on the authority approval of Puerto Rico's budget. That's exactly the setup that applied in the D.C. Control Board. With respect to government operating corporations, like the electric company, the sewer company, the highway company, these are the entities that Chapter 9 applies to. I'll come back to that. The authority needs to have the power to fix the problems, the power to fire and hire and renegotiate contracts, restructure pensions, restructure operations. And when it has done that, yes, then we think it should have the power to restructure its debt with a majority of the bondholders voting in favor, which is, I think, something the IMF has tried to install in the international arena. The one power neither the authority nor Puerto Rico should have, in our view, is access to Chapter 9. Chapter 9 is a way to avoid reforms rather than implement them, and we think it causes far more problems than it solves. First, it doesn't help. The crisis that everybody refers to is in the general government. Chapter 9 does not apply to the general government, and no one on this that I've heard in Congress, including Representative Pierluisi, has suggested that it should, because then it would be equivalent to applying Chapter 9 to a state, which Congress has never done. So, with respect to the government corporations that Chapter 9 would apply to, let's enumerate the problems. First, it doesn't raise money. Every now and then I hear that corporations can go into bankruptcy and they can raise money. Well, I've been practicing bankruptcy law a long time, and lenders don't lend money in any bankrupt situation unless they have collateral. And with respect to the government corporations of Puerto Rico, there is no collateral. All the money has been pledged to the bondholders. The only source of liquidity is a deal with the bondholders. And we have such a deal. We have a deal at the Puerto Rican Electric Power Authority. We negotiated it months ago. It's waiting for legislation in Puerto Rico to be effectuated. And there was a liquidity problem at the Puerto Rican Electric Power Authority, and we fixed it. The bondholders fixed it. We loaned the money. We suggest that as a template for how to deal with Puerto Rico's other governmental corporations. Chapter 9 does not implement reforms. And I ask you to compare the experience of the District of Columbia with the City of Detroit. The District of Columbia, actually, there was a consideration of giving D.C. Chapter 9. It's in the congressional reports. And it was debated, and Congress said, no, Chapter 9 doesn't fix problems. So they established a control board, and the control board did what needed to be done. It cut the size of government. It eliminated the deficit, turned it to surplus, brought the bonds back to investment grade. The private sector flourished, and the results you have today, the district is a AA rated entity. Now let's take a look at Detroit, which some people like to mention as a success. Detroit went into Chapter 9, and it used Chapter 9 to crush its bondholders, to largely isolate the pensions from any change. And it went into Chapter 9 with 28 city agencies, and it came out of Chapter 9 with 28 city agencies. And as a result today, despite what you may have heard, Detroit has no access to municipal finance. It can only borrow through the state of Michigan. Detroit's own paper trades at 23 cents on the dollar. Like Detroit, Puerto Rico has a gross abundance of government agencies. It has 120 government agencies, which is one of the witnesses testified he could not fix. If you give Chapter 9 to Puerto Rico, it won't reduce this problem. And unlike, if I may, unlike Detroit, Puerto Rico doesn't have Michigan. It has the federal government. If you give it Chapter 9, it's going to be back. My people have been investing in Puerto Rico for 30 years. We'd like to invest for another 30 years. We're not short-term players. We look forward to working with this committee to crafting a solution that works for everyone. Thank you.
I thank you, sir. I was listening to your proposal on oil that you, the ranking member. You said one word that disturbs me a great deal, the appointment of the control board confirmed by the Senate. Let's forget that part because it'll never happen. I'm serious about that. I watched this, so we'll eliminate that word. You know, that's the dark hole. Mr. Paralisi?
Mr. Chairman, I apologize. I'm really far more focused on making sure the control board has the quality people that it needs than how
we will have it confirmed by the House. How's that? That'd be a lot better.
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Paralisi.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm going to try to lay out a couple of facts that I believe are beyond dispute, or at the very least are supported by the vast majority of my constituents. The first one is that Puerto Rico is facing a very serious, unprecedented liquidity crisis. There are payments in the immediate horizon that, for all intents and purposes, unless the government of Puerto Rico obtains access, adequate access to the markets, the government's gonna fail in making. You're gonna have massive defaults starting possibly in May of this year, in all likelihood in July of this year. And that's no good for anybody. It's not good for creditors. It is not good for the people of Puerto Rico. It is not good for Congress. It is not good for the municipal markets, and I can go on. So we need to deal with that. Another fact, the budgeting system of the government of Puerto Rico, the accounting system, the financial reporting system, leaves a lot to be desired, needs to be reformed and drastically. Everybody agrees. Third, uncontested fact, Puerto Rico's, the amount of public debt in Puerto Rico equals Puerto Rico's GNP. By any measure, that's a lot of debt. And Puerto Rico hasn't been growing ever since 8 or 9 years ago. So that's the scenario. With that scenario in mind, I tell you, Mayor Williams, I believe that the majority of people of Puerto Rico support a concept of a federal oversight board assisting Puerto Rico in fixing what I just mentioned, putting our fiscal house in order. Within reason. But the board itself is not going to be a solution. You also need to provide Puerto Rico with either better treatment in federal programs or otherwise access to the financial markets so that we do not fail to comply with our obligations in the markets. And that's the challenge that we should address here, and I hope that you can comment on. Lastly, and let me just be specific about a couple of examples. DC, the way that the Medicaid programs works in the states, the federal government provides a substantial amount of the funding. In the case of DC, the federal government was giving you 50%, Mayor Williams, you know that. And then as a result of the Revitalization Act, which was part of the legislative package, the Congress increased it to 70%, and it assisted DC. Professor Johnson mentions the EITC program, Earned Income Tax
credit program, which is the best anti-poverty program in the states. In Puerto Rico, we have extremely low labor participation rate. We need to create jobs, get the people to work in the formal economy. That would be a great tool. So I'll leave it at that. I would like both of you to comment on specific measures, apart from instituting a board that could assist Puerto Rico in getting into a path towards recovery.
You only gave a minute and 19 seconds.
I think the entity in the entity in Washington, D.C. was able to do something very important, and that, I think, was to begin establishing an environment of success, a climate for investment, very importantly for citizens and investors. I think when you're these issues about migration, it created a environment for investment where people wanted to invest again where they wanted to live. How was that done? Create reliable financial information. Create reliable government financial operations. Before you ask for anything, make sure you're collecting, you know, before you, not only collecting your revenue, cashing your checks. We had checks and bundles on a floor in a room. We weren't even cashing checks. So cash your checks, collect your revenue, manage your government operations, create settled expectations. Begin bringing down the size of government. Not that the size of government alone is a solution, but how can you create confidence unless you're addressing fundamental government operations? Building on that, and on that basis, then you're looking at your balance sheet and you're saying, okay, on the basis of all this, we're collecting the revenue we can, we've reduced government operations, you know what? We still need to look at our relationship with the federal government. I think that ought to be the approach here. Look at restructuring debt, look at the relationship with the federal government, look at these things after you've put the basic housekeeping in order. And while you're doing that, you certainly need liquidity, but that's different to me than doing the Chapter 9 kind of solution in Detroit.
I'm going to let
Johnson, Professor
Mr. Johnson, comment for 1 minute. He used most of his time up giving a great presentation, but I'll let Mr. Johnson 1 minute. Start that time over.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, these programs were exactly what I had in mind when I agreed with you, Mr. Chairman, at the beginning. If Puerto Rico were a state, we would not have the same crisis today. The cap on Medicaid for Puerto Rico, which is not doesn't exist for the states. EITC, absolutely, very important program for states with lots of poor people, not available at all to Puerto Rico. And the child tax credit as well, Mr. Pierluisi, which you've proposed to extend to Puerto Rico. Again, it makes complete sense. Now, this would, of course, change the terms of the financial relationship between Puerto Rico and the federal government. I understand that. And it would be taking on some additional obligations with the federal government. I understand that, too. I think the two reasons to consider this, one is, you're treating Puerto Rico more like a state, and that is how Puerto Rico should be treated in this fiscal relationship. Second thing is, in the historical precedence that we have, including particularly D.C., my understanding as a D.C. taxpayer is that the relationship between the federal government and the D.C. government changed in terms of what the federal government was responsible for. Those terms were adjusted in the favor of D.C., and I think that's that adjustment that would be very helpful and appropriate to Puerto Rico right now.
Thank you, and with that, Mr. Labrador, you want to go? You want to go next?
I think you did the other subcommittee members first before we get to the non.
Well, Labrador's not one, but I want a Republican.
Okay.
Mr. Labrador, would you like? You're not a member of the subcommittee, but you are welcome to go ahead, especially when you start mimicking me. I really appreciate it.
I'm trying to be as handsome as you.
There
are.
You want 10 minutes? No, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Pierluisi. Thank you, everyone, and especially the witnesses for being here. This is a very important issue. I happen to serve on both committees that are dealing with this issue. I'm serving in the Judiciary Committee where we will be looking at the bankruptcy issue, and I'm serving in this committee where we're looking at the Oversight Board. I really appreciate the work that has been done by a lot of people. And at the Energy and Mineral Resources Subcommittee's hearing last month, I make the point that nothing said at the hearing or elsewhere should really be interpreted as encouraging the government of Puerto Rico to delay any kind of actions that they need to do right now. I think there's some things that they should be doing right now that will help us in our understanding of where they want to go with this fiscal situation. I think that should be, it's important for them. I had the great privilege of meeting with the Speaker of the House of Puerto Rico, and we had a really fantastic conversation about what they're trying to do, and I'm encouraging them to take some steps right now before we even decide in Congress what we're going to be doing. I have a couple of questions for you, Mr. Williams, and I appreciate your vast experience in dealing with this. I wonder if you could comment on what Mr. Morse Meyer, I think I'm saying your name correctly, what he said about the financial. He talked about the difference between Detroit and Washington, D.C., and he said that you guys did not, and I hope I understood this correctly, you guys did not have Chapter 9. All you had was the oversight board. And he talked about the difference in the result of what happened with Chapter 9, where Detroit now is still financially unstable, but it seems like Washington, D.C. is doing much better. Could you please speak to those comments that he made?
I think it is important. I mean, timing is of the essence, but I think it's important to build confidence, create these expectations I'm talking about before you ask for incentives, however they're warranted by past experience, and they certainly were warranted in D.C., before you ask for additional changes or in relationship with the federal government. A great example would be Medicaid. We didn't really get the Medicaid change until I was mayor, and it was based on the confidence we had built in reforming the government that the House and the Senate appropriate committees finally gave us a 70-30 versus a 50-50 Medicaid. Likewise with the Revitalization Act and the spinoff of a number of things that our government was doing that we shouldn't have been doing. If we had tried to do that at the beginning with a lack of confidence we had, I think it would have been a non-starter. So I think these things are essential. This relationship with the federal government is essential, but you've got to create you're asking me to be here. You've got to create a climate of confidence, settled expectations before you can begin to look at these larger issues.
I think you're hitting my point exactly, because I understand that we need a financial control board.
Right.
I am undecided about the bankruptcy, but I'm open to it. I'm open to the bankruptcy protections, but it seems to me that bankruptcy is not a plan. Bankruptcy is a step in a plan, and I'm not sure where that bankruptcy protection should come in, if at all. Mr. Carlos Garcia, could you speak to that issue a little bit, and specifically to what Mr. Williams is saying, that the government of Puerto Rico needs to build, and I agree with him 100%, needs to build the confidence that they're moving forward with the appropriate plan.
I agree with that, and that's the reason why I shared some of our experience when we had the control board from 2009-2011, and that was the first point, being able to establish the confidence of all the stakeholders. It was not only the bondholders, but it was everybody and all the constituents. It was a lot of hard work, but by doing that hard work is what gains the confidence of everybody else to be able to manage all the other issues. In regards to the restructuring mechanisms, I mean, I agree, it's a tool. But right now, the consequences and the issues of Puerto Rico is not only solving a very complicated fiscal situation, but it's trying to find a path that finally provides the opportunity for Puerto Rico to be able to grow, so we don't have to be dealing with this again in 2 years, in 5 years, or 10 years. So it has to be a comprehensive solution. And as I mentioned on my testimony, it has to do a lot with the loss of an economic model in Puerto Rico. If you're not able to combine those two measures, and finally, if you don't provide a single resolution mechanism that allows to be able to balance the equities, as I mentioned, the formal debts are very important, but all the other compromise and commitments that Puerto Rico had made to their pensions, to health, and to the well-being of Puerto Rico need to be balanced. And I think that doing it through the authority in combination with all other powers will be the best way to go at this time.
Thank you. And Mr. Morse Meyer, if the people of Puerto Rico and the government of Puerto Rico do all the things that are necessary to gain that financial stability and to gain that financial confidence, and we still see that the bankruptcy should be a step in the process, why would you be opposed to that?
Thank you for asking that question. All we want is the vote. We want the ability to vote on a restructuring plan for the governmental corporations. And it's important to mention again that when we talk about the crisis, when we talk about health care, when we talk about payments of pensions, you're always talking about obligations of the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico itself, with respect to which Chapter 9 simply would not apply. And if Puerto Rico were a state, Chapter 9 would definitely not apply, and there might even be constitutional issues as to whether or not Chapter 9 could apply. So you're only talking about governmental corporations. You're talking about the electric company, the sewer company, and the highway company. And yes, we think an authority could provide solutions to the operating problems of those authorities. And when it does, our people would be prepared to vote by the right majorities to do a deal. We did that in the Puerto Rican Electric Power Authority, and the model for that is apparently acceptable enough that legislators in Puerto Rico are thinking about applying it to the sewer authority. So you've got a limited number of government corporations that are in the process of working this out, and would we accept a majority rules clause with respect to that corporate debt? Yes, we would, after the improvements have been made.
Okay, thank you. My time has expired.
Thank you, sir. The chair, ranking member of the committee, Mr. Gravel.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And when you were admonishing the person with the white hair for popping up and down, I was glad it wasn't Chairman Bishop that you were looking at that point.
I was looking to my left.
We were both relieved, thank you. You know, the debt crisis in Puerto Rico, Mr. Chairman, is a major part of the problem we're facing, which makes, to some extent, the comparisons to D.C. a little off. In fact, I don't think it's the right comparison. When we talk about control boards, unbridled, full control boards, answerable to no constituency or other elected officials being made irrelevant in the process, and other civic organizations participating, I think we should be probably comparing Puerto Rico in that absolute sense to Flint, Michigan, where austerity as the main vehicle for balancing books and bringing things into line has produced a crisis that we see now with lead poisoning. I think the definition of what we mean by oversight is critical in any legislation. And I think that the issue of all the stakeholders being part of the process is fine with me. But I think that we have to, there's humanity involved here, and that has to be taken into account. And I wanted to ask you, Mr. LeCompte, Bloomberg government recently released an analysis of lobbying data and found that in the second and third quarter of 2015 alone, over $47 million was spent lobbying on Puerto Rican issues. The numbers give you some idea as to the scale of profit at stake here. The businesses spending this much money on lobbying see their level of spending as on lobbying as a worthwhile investment toward profits, which means they're probably significantly bigger. A dollar that goes into that process to hedge funds or other investors being the first in line is a dollar that doesn't go to schools, nurses, police, and fire protection. You've mentioned austerity that has already visited the families of Puerto Rico. Can you expand on what it looks like day to day without any mechanism for restructuring and without any oversight mechanism that still respects the citizens?
Well, Congressman Grijalva, the situation on the ground is absolutely grave. Working with the religious leaders and the religious institutions that are really on the front lines of dealing with a crisis where nearly one out of two people already lived in poverty, we're seeing daily self-imposed austerity continue on the island. The most recent being that special ed teachers had their salaries cut, greater cuts to health care on the island. It's absolutely desperate. And I think it's also important, because I certainly agree with my colleagues on the panel and the different viewpoints that have been lifted by the various members of the committee, the creditors themselves are a diverse group. The religious institutions that we represent, the Catholic Church, all of the mainline Protestant groups in Puerto Rico are creditors. The various unions in Puerto Rico are creditors. These are groups that own Puerto Rico bonds and have substantial commitments. At the same time, they understand very clearly that there needs to be a haircut to get the debt back to sustainable levels. I think in terms of the lobbying issues that you've raised, you know, I think there are many creditors that have very legitimate stakes and want a resolution that makes the most sense to benefit the people of Puerto Rico and also be able to get some economic growth back behind their investment. But I think there is a small group of investors that is trying to prevent any kind of process from moving forward. And I think that group doesn't care about the austerity that's continuing. They just cared about getting paid.
Thank you, Mr. John. Mr. Johnson, there's a consensus that Puerto Rico's capacity to repay its debt ultimately depends on restoring economic growth on the island, and that there can be no economic recovery without significant restructuring of the debt. While I'm aware that there are negotiations ongoing between the government of Puerto Rico and its creditors on an agreement to restructuring the debt, wouldn't a process such as Chapter 9 or some other similar regimen be more effective in a way to obtain true debt restructuring rather than a voluntary agreement where all sides could walk away at any time?
Well, Congressman, I think that is absolutely a key question to be asking today. And I would emphasize there's a continuum of choices for Congress to make. On the one hand, you could choose to allow bankruptcy, the Chapter 9, which has already been discussed. On the other hand, you could prefer to leave it entirely as a voluntary process, which is hard. There are also some intermediate approaches, and I think this is why having a growth authority approach is a very good one. The growth authority could have the ability to negotiate these deals and to, subject to some voting, and if the creditors want to be reasonable, or willing to be reasonable, that is absolutely the best way forward, subject to being able to get growth back, which is important for the creditors as well as for all the citizens of Puerto Rico. And in that intermediate case, you probably do need permission. You need some sort of arrangement where a court would approve, say, a prepackaged restructuring in order to prevent a relatively few creditors from holding out. Now, what Mr. Myers was talking about with a majority voting, typically, if you have a majority, then you don't. The holdouts have to surrender their debt on the same terms. So addressing, I think you want to think comprehensively. And what I'm also talking about in the intermediate solution is not just the municipal debt, not just the debt that sometimes people talk about, you know, could be under Chapter 9 if this were a state. I'm suggesting that all of the obligations of Puerto Rico be reviewed and assessed by this growth authority with a view to a restructuring that's fair and equitable, doesn't treat all creditors the same way, because there are different classes of creditors, but all of the debt should be included in that assessment that will be delegated, presumably, to the authority with the backing of the court system.
But it's important to note that such authority has never been granted to any state in the union. And if you want Puerto Rico to be treated like a state, then you have to treat the obligations of the Commonwealth as if you would treat the state obligations.
You can't grant this to a state. Puerto Rico is not a state. It's not being treated like
Mr.
a state.
Mr. Johnson, please. Mr. Reese.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Puerto Rico is part of our nation, and we have a responsibility to the Puerto Rican people to provide them with the tools and opportunities to achieve the American dream. It is nearly indisputable at this point that Puerto Rico is faced with a debt crisis, a crisis that if we fail to address will break our promise to the Puerto Rican people, to our fellow American citizens. I appreciate that this hearing has been convened to explore how we can become part of the solution and what pragmatic steps should be taken to empower Puerto Rico to succeed. I also want to remind everybody that a budget is a reflection of our values and that people are more than a spreadsheet. Numbers in that spreadsheet have a story, and they have lives. And so we want to set up the restructuring process to help set up Puerto Rico to succeed. And in most of these committees and councils with that have financial responsibility and advice, there's a lot of cutting, there's a lot of austerity measures that does not really deal with the growth of a community such as Puerto Rico. And so the things that we want for growth include the education, the workforce development, the infrastructure development, job training, and also healthcare. So how will those factors play into a committee such as one that we're thinking of, the board? Anybody?
I think the right kind of entity can create, again, a level of confidence where economic incentives begin to work, where the right restructuring of government begins to feed into that client. You basically turning a vicious cycle into a virtuous cycle, create economic investment. And I would respectfully disagree with the congressman. I think the experience in D.C., the experience in Philadelphia, the experience in New York, the experience in Cleveland with then Mayor Voinovich is that the right kind of leadership with the right control entity can not only right-size the government, if you will, but as everyone is saying, and most importantly, begin to create a climate for economic investment and growth.
Well, I don't think there was any disagreement in that statement, because I think that the council can do both, or the board can do both, and that was my point. Professor Johnson?
So, Congressman, if you take the example of energy, cost of energy in Puerto Rico, I think this is very important. It's expensive, and it's much more expensive, for example, than in Florida, in part because the plant used is out of date, and they don't use natural gas, for example, would be considerably cheaper. So this is a sector that is crying out for investment. It's essential to all parts of the economy. You're not going to get investment in that sector unless you sort out the debt overhang issue. And going forward, presumably, there's a role for some public sector, but also the private sector in this. And I think the chairman, again, put his finger at the beginning where he said, you want to create an environment for investment. I think that's what Mayor Williams is saying as
thank
well.
You. With respect, Professor Johnson, there is a deal to create that investment. We've spent 18 months negotiating it.
Thank you very much. This is my last question to Mr. LeComte. Self-empowerment is very important to the people of Puerto Rico. It's very important to me. How can we incorporate citizen participation in this process?
Well, thank you. I think that's absolutely critical. I think any process that moves forward must not only include the people of Puerto Rico, but it also must move forward a process where there's greater accountability to the government to the people of Puerto Rico from their government itself. And I think that's been a key reason why the Archbishop of San Juan and the other religious leaders have continued to call for public budget transparency in this process. You know, I certainly agree with Mr. Mayor in terms of what he's putting out in terms of bankruptcy is not comprehensive in itself. Bankruptcy is one part of a process that needs to take place, just like greater degrees of accountability and transparency. There are several ways that that can move forward. I think the most important way is one of the actions Congress has already taken, which is being able to provide assistance from the U.S. Treasury and their Office of Technical Assistance, which I think is one of the greatest programs at U.S. Treasury. And this in itself can provide Puerto Rico with critical advice to keep their debt stock in good order, but even more importantly, create greater accountability mechanisms with the people of Puerto Rico to the government itself. So I think these are very important. I think any particular conversation around a fiscal control board or growth authority, for representation on that, it's absolutely critical that you have equal representation from Puerto Rico, the federal government, and certainly the kind of staffing that Mayor Williams has talked about in terms of being able to have the kind of technical expertise to support the process.
Gentlemen's time has expired. Mr. Bishop.
Thank you. I appreciate the witnesses being here. I actually have four questions. I'm going to ask two to Mr. Mayor and two to Mayor Williams. And so let me go with those as we talk about them. But before I do that, Mayor Williams, anyone who can do as much as you did to bring baseball to Washington, I have confidence that we can solve this problem as well. And when there's a big league team in San Juan, then we will have arrived. All right. By the way, that is more important than this issue. So. Very soon, this committee, with Ms. Pierluisi's assistance, is going to be drafting legislation that's going to address the situation in Puerto Rico. So there are some questions I think are really important just on the overall level to them. So Mr. Mayor, I'm going to ask you, for those who advocate simply bankruptcy protection from Puerto Rico, the question is, how will Puerto Rico ever go back into the bond market for financing of infrastructure that they're going to have to have? And those who advocate against bankruptcy, how will Puerto Rico bring recalcitrant creditors to the table to discuss debt restructuring? Now, let me give the other two questions you can think about that. So, Mayor Williams, I'm sorry. For those who advocate an advisory-type board, how will government of Puerto Rico convince anybody it's going to follow the board's advice when it appears that the government has already taken sound advice and has ignored that advice? But for those who advocate a strong control board, how will such a board carry out its purpose and have the proper respect for the people of the island and the integrity of their government? So, Mr. Mayor, if I could ask you those first two, and then Mayor Williams.
Thank you, Chairman Bishop. I don't think Puerto Rico will easily recover access to the capital markets if it ever uses Chapter 9. And I think that it will have serious knock-on effects across the country. Just last week, the Chicago Board of Education came to market with an $800 million bond issue, but because of the concerns about Puerto Rico and because Illinois is considering giving Chicago Chapter 9, it couldn't sell the paper. So the history, if you take a look at the last five, six big cases, if you look at Detroit, if you look at the California cases, none of these municipalities has been able to go back to the market unless they have a special structure through a state, as Detroit had through Michigan. So this is one of the reasons why we have focused on a restructuring with a creditor vote, a real vote, where the bondholders feel they have a chance to vote yes or no, than a Chapter 9, which pretends to have a creditor vote but doesn't really, where creditor votes are not important and are routinely disregarded. So in answer to your question, I don't think Puerto Rico will regain access to the capital markets if it is given Chapter 9, that it authorizes the public corporations to do so. Right now, the electric company has access to the capital markets if it implements our deal. It doesn't need Professor Johnson's government intervention. And that deal is being talked about as a template for the sewer company. You have a limited number of governmental corporations, even if they have $20 billion of debt. This process can work out if you let it do so.
Thank you. Let me turn to the mayor. Can you ask, these are the fundamental questions we've got to address as a committee. So if it's an advisory type board, based on the record, how do we ensure that it's going to happen? If it's a strong board, how do we ensure that we respect the rights of the people of the government of Puerto Rico?
Congressman, first of all, I'm glad you enjoy the games, and I appreciate that. But, I spoke at an event.
Except when they were playing the Mets. Those sucked. But other than that, yeah.
I've spoken at an event with Speaker Gingrich, who was one of the leaders in the D.C. recovery, along with President Clinton. And what the Speaker and I was talking about is, with a board, you really needed two things. We keep reiterating, everybody here. You need the control and the oversight. You need to look at the break even of the government and get it to the right level. But you also need economic growth. And I believe that only a strong board puts you in a position to do that. So I would go with the latter. And it's very important, that said, that this board be able to work with people on the ground, everybody from the business community to the unions to the pensioners, the teachers, the non-governmental community, to put in place a vision for recovery. And I think, again, the cities that I mentioned, you've seen that, and I think you can see this on the island. And I've spoken down in San Juan to the people in the government about this. So what I'm saying, I believe strongly. I believe that this notion that a strong entity, is like Darth Vader and everybody's going to run for the hills, I think if it's done in the right way in conjunction with the people on the ground, in conjunction with the government, I think it can work.
I think you're all talking about having the right people involved in making those decisions. I think Mr. Garcia was saying the same thing. Competency precedes before the incentives that have to be there. I appreciate that very well, and I also thank you for mentioning one of the concepts. This committee has already explored the idea of energy development. Obviously, the energy costs in Puerto Rico are significantly higher than the rest of the country, and it's part of the problem they have with their economic development. If we don't address that at the same time, we are missing an opportunity of doing what has to be done. I yield back. Sorry to go over.
Ms. Torres.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In 2009, as a newly member of the House in the state of California, I saw the eighth largest economy dwindle down to junk bond status. We had a $15 billion deficit, and it was a very, very difficult time in the state managing finances. The House, the Senate couldn't agree on cuts or a lot of things that we needed to do. The one thing that helped us out of that mess was greater transparency. We began to put our budget on the website. We began a process of seeking input from citizens all across the state asking, how would you balance your budget? What would, if you're limited to this much money, what would that look like for you? And what are your priorities? And certainly, there were a lot of difficult votes in that. Today, we're seeing the negative part of that with teachers that have left the state, and we are unable to recruit good teachers. And that's something that the current legislature is having to deal with. Mr. Williams, you were the mayor of Washington when the control board was put in place, correct? Yes. Can you share with us what were some of the positive as well as negative issues that you saw when that board was implemented, and how did the people of Washington, how did the residents were able to make opinions and have their voices heard, and the government, how were they, you as a mayor, how was your voice heard?
I came into the control board as a CFO. As a CFO, I thought it was really important, first and foremost, to put our financial affairs in order, to create the right kind of organizational and systems and financial reporting, just to get to ground zero, very, very important. And then on that basis, restoring fundamental financial operations like paying the bills. I know this sounds ridiculous, but like paying the bills.
But were you, that was not a priority for you before that, to pay the bills?
Yes, we had lines of people, I mean, literally out the door with receivables demanding to be paid. Checks that weren't cash, let alone receivables that weren't properly managed and recorded. Then as we began doing that, what I saw was a need, given that as the CFO and the control board, we had all this authority, I thought it was very important to go out to the neighborhoods and give a understanding, a briefing to the citizens of the city. I was just a financial guy. Give a briefing to the citizens of the city about what was going on. And the analogy I used was that we were on a really hard road as a city in a really overloaded car that was badly driven and underpowered.
But what were the positives and the negatives of that board, sir?
The positives of the board is that it had the authority to comprehensively deal with all the issues we're talking about.
Overriding the authority of the local elected officials?
No, it had the authority to supersede in the breach decisions of the local officials, but actually as a process worked in collaboration with the Congress and with the local officials.
Was there a lot of cooperation from your perspective?
What I was trying to say was I tried to ensure that there was cooperation with the consul.
Okay, tried and succeed are two different things. Was there cooperation, yes or no?
Yeah, we tried and we succeeded in building cooperation with the local citizenry. The fact that I was elected mayor after representing the control board, I think speaks to the rapport I was able to achieve. I mean. Right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Velasquez.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman and the ranking member and the ranking member of the committee and subcommittee, thank you so much for allowing us to participate in this hearing. I don't have to explain how important this is for all the Puerto Rican members of Congress. We have families in Puerto Rico, all my families in Puerto Rico, and as we have stated before, not only we are concerned about the ability of Puerto Rico to restructure its debt, but the humanitarian crisis that is already unfolding if we do not approach this issue in a comprehensive way. Here we are talking about a financial control board. And reading the wonderful memo that was put together, it says here that in New York, the Emergency Financial Control Board reduced a huge deficit by forcing the city to shed 60,000 employees, 20% of the workforce. And then it went on to talk about Washington, D.C. Well, let me tell you what Puerto Rico has been doing without a control board. It has raised its sales tax to 11.5%, the highest in the nation, reduced government employment by 13,000 over the last 3 years, and cut expenses by 20%. It has also undertaken pension reform, froze collective bargaining agreements, and consolidated hundreds of schools. And Puerto Rico is already taking emergency measures to avoid defaulting on its general obligation bonds. It has done so by borrowing $400 million from the Workers' Compensation Fund, liquidating assets from pension funds, extending third-party payables to almost $2 billion, and defaulting on junior debts in the outstanding principal amount of $7 billion. We can keep going down this path, but the truth is that the course is set and there's no turning back for Puerto Rico without help from the U.S. Congress. Mr. Mayor, Mr. Williams, you're here to discuss how effective the control board was to return D.C. To manage its financial crisis. I just would like to ask you, when a control board was created for Washington, D.C., how critical of an issue was the district debt load?
I'm not an expert on, Congresswoman, I'm not an expert on the debt. I think I'm not really here as an expert on the debt. I'm really here on the experience of the board in executing a financial recovery and the different aspects we talked about. The situations are different. The debt situation in the district's clearly and markedly different from the debt situation in Puerto Rico.
So, Mr. Williams, Mr. Johnson, do you believe that given Puerto Rico's debt problem, that a control board alone will permit the island to recover, or does it need a restructuring authority as well? And to go beyond Chapter 9, financial, a broader version of restructuring.
I think, Ms. Velasquez, you put it exactly right. You're on a, Puerto Rico's on a downward path right now with partial debt restructurings and agreements and so on. They will, the territory will continue on that downward path unless a sharp change is made. I support having a growth authority as part of that change. I think you also should change the fiscal relationship with the federal government, which is part of what you're talking about. And I do think that even in the positive scenarios, when as growth comes back, that some fair, equitable debt restructuring should be on the table. The growth authority hopefully will have the power to take that on and to do that in a responsible and equitable way. But yes, I think all of the debt should be on the table.
Thank you. And Mr. Johnson, you stated in your testimony that creditors were taking on well-documented risks when they lent to Puerto Rico, and that the biggest danger for Puerto Rico is that there will be no comprehensive debt restructuring. What do you say to those that suggest that it's unfair for creditors to suffer losses due to a potential debt restructuring?
Well, in such situations, of course, creditors are never happy, nor are the people of Puerto Rico happy. This is not where you want to be. But I've not heard anyone today or any other day recently say that there's anything surprising about this situation. I think all of our accounts, we may differ on precisely what happened, but all our accounts begin 10, 20 years ago, at least, in terms of the unraveling of public finances in Puerto Rico.
My understanding is that the hedge funds that bought the totality of Puerto Rico's bond issuance in 2014 did so without current audited financial statement. So for those who saying that Puerto Rico doesn't provide the type of statement that are necessary, is they knew without, prior to buying those bonds, the financial conditions of Puerto Rico.
Congresswoman.
Gentlemen, time is up. Mr. Gutierrez.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, Resident Commissioner Pedrisi, for allowing me to participate today. So I just want to make a few points, and that is I'm just going to go back to the memorandum that was issued to everyone here. And at the end of the second paragraph on background, it says, Congress retains plenary authority under Article 4, Section 3, Clause 2 of the U.S. Constitution to determine the ultimate disposition of the political status of Puerto Rico. The fact is that the Congress of the United States retains plenary powers over everything in Puerto Rico, not just the status of Puerto Rico, and that is fundamentally what should be at issue, too, at this hearing, because you can't resolve one without the other. You want to take the government of Puerto Rico that doesn't control how merchandise is brought in or out, because the Jones Act says we must use the U.S. Merchant Marines. We're not going to discuss that here today, tomorrow, or any time between now and March 31st, yet the consumers in Puerto Rico need. You want to talk about economic development? How do you have economic development if your energy is outlandishly expensive? And if you don't invest in making sure that you have a clear water supply in a tropical island? So look, there's a lot of things, but fundamentally, let's deal with one thing, because the background statement doesn't say it. Why don't we just all come to the conclusion, which I'm sure Mr. Pierluisi agrees as the resident commissioner of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is a colony of the United States of America. Puerto Rico is war booty from the war in 1898. How does Puerto Rico become part of the United States of America? It wasn't like the Puerto Ricans all got together one day, held a convention, and said, would you allow us? No, it was military intervention in Puerto Rico. Now, I like to say to the resident commissioner, I agree, and I'm going to fight with you to maintain some sense of reliability between what we do here and the functioning of the people of Puerto Rico over their future. But I fear that we might be trying to make a distinction without a difference. In that the truth is that we don't control in Puerto Rico any of the basic things. We don't control who comes to the island or who leaves the island, because that's controlled by the federal government. Our court system? No, you simply appeal to the Supreme Court. You simply appeal to a federal court and the Supreme Court of the United States and the laws that we pass here. So, when people say, oh, the people of Puerto Rico, they're responsible for everything that happened bad there and they need to take responsibility, no. The Congress of the United States has to assume responsibility over Puerto Rico because we have, as stated here, plenary powers over the people of Puerto Rico. Why are we having this hearing here? And why aren't they having it in Puerto Rico? Because they can't have it there because they don't have those plenary powers. So look, I'm concerned about senior citizens, Mr. Mayor. And I'm hopeful that the Franklin Fund has diversified their funds to the point, because I don't want you to make it sound like the only thing in that fund are Puerto Rican bonds, because they're not. I checked before I came to this hearing. You're a very well-diversified fund, and I hope you fulfilled your fiduciary responsibility to the people that you sold the bonds to and informed them of the precarious situation of the very bonds that you were purchasing. So don't put on us the responsibility of something that you sold to senior citizens, okay? Make sure that you understand that you too have a responsibility as the market in the United States of America. So I just want to say, look, everything is different in Puerto Rico. Everything is. Can't even go to McDonald's. The menu's in Spanish. Everything is different. Because Puerto Rico belongs to, but is not a part of, the United States of America. And I'm not saying that. That's what the Supreme Court of the United States of America has stated. Puerto Rico is a colony of the United States. There's no way around it. Otherwise, we would not be here. And the statement as made by the committee, very ably, that we have plenary powers over the people of Puerto Rico. So here's what I would suggest. Number one, let's restructure this debt fully. It's not a state. I didn't come here to try to make Puerto Rico more like a state. I came here to make the Puerto Rican people whole so that they could have a future. Let's restore the ability of the people of Puerto Rico to invite people to Puerto Rico. Let's stop fighting over what is the reality of the people of Puerto Rico and what they need. Lastly, Mr. Chairman, can't we provide the people of Puerto Rico the incentives to create jobs, 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 economic activity, instead of expansion of more welfare programs in Puerto Rico? What we need is jobs so the people of Puerto Rico can use their intelligence. Because when the people of Puerto Rico leave and vanish from that island to come to the United States of America, guess what they do? They come here to work because they're bright, intelligent people. Let the Congress of the United States take the heel off the people of Puerto Rico and let them live prosperously. Let them have the economic development that they so deserve. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for having these hearings. I look for a resolution by March the 31st of this year, as Speaker Ryan has so promised.
Mr. Serrano, sorry you were here first here and had to be the last. I do apologize.
That's okay, Mr. Chairman. And thank you and to all the other committee leaders for allowing the three non-members of the committee to participate. I was very interested in Mr. Gutierrez's statement because I'm not going to say that he says the same thing I've been saying. That would be unfair, but it sounded similar to something I've been saying all along, which is what we're doing here, and I'm part of it, and what we will do by March 31st, hopefully, and I'm part of it and support it, is putting a Band-Aid on a larger problem. The problem is the status of Puerto Rico. As long as Puerto Rico is a colony of the United States, these kinds of issues will recur and recur and recur. The only solution is to resolve the political status. 117 years is a long, long time for Puerto Rico to be a colony, and it's about time that it ended, and I'm supportive of anything that ends the colonial status. As long as the people who are much brighter than I on this issue come to me and say, Puerto Rico is no longer a territory of the U.S., then whatever the change is, I'll be fine with. And I think I'm hearing more and more and more folks who were opposed to change saying we don't have the power, therefore we need change. And that is very important. Mr. Williams, Mayor Williams, I lived with you the whole time. I was chairman and ranking member of the subcommittee. First subcommittee on appropriations when D.C. was a committee by itself, if you recall those days, and then when he became part of financial services where I'm ranking member now. And I have to tell you that when members spoke within ourselves, which we often do, regardless of what the public thinks, you got a lot of credit for what happened in D.C. because you did something that I want should not be lost on this argument, at this hearing, which is you demanded respect for Washington with a control board, but you were willing to work with the federal government to resolve the problem. Let me repeat that. You demanded respect, and I remember you in front of us at the committee hearing saying, you're asking me to do something that is not dignified for the people of Washington, D.C., while understanding that you had to work with us. And many, many, many people said at that time, members of Congress, who were not crazy about D.C. You know, D.C. has always been the place that people beat up on, said that you deserved a lot of credit. And I think the history books will say that besides the Nationals, you did a lot for this city during that period of time, and I applaud you for that. But incidentally, Mr. Chairman, all the city council members who gave him a hard time about the Nationals, showed up on opening day because I was there, and they were they were taking credit for it. Mr. Meyer, I'm a little confused. According to my information, and you correct me if I'm wrong, you're a member of the National Bankruptcy Conference. Is that correct?
That is correct.
But the conference supports Chapter 9 extension to Puerto Rico, and you do not.
That is also correct. I abstained from the debate at the conference on that topic, and my views are not the views of the conference.
Okay, and the conference knows that you're testifying or that you disagree with them and they're testifying in that way, saying that you do not support Chapter 9 while the conference does.
That is correct, yes.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, just a note. Our biggest challenge will not be finding a solution or getting what the Speaker Ryan has promised to take place. It's going back to the same issue of how do you give the territory the needed assistance while not making it more of a colony, not more colonialism. And you're going to have members of Congress who are not going to think that way, who are going to say, if they're going to get help, they have to pay. Well, an oversight board is fine. The resident commissioner has said that oversight is fine. Oversight exists already. Every single dollar that goes to Puerto Rico or to any state or to any municipality, you have to answer to the federal government for it. You have to answer to the Appropriations Committee for it. That should be the case. But to bring Puerto Rico on its knees when it's already on one knee would be just to add more pain to a situation that is very painful. I find myself in a unique situation. I was born in the colony, and now I'm a member of Congress of the group that holds the colony. And so sometimes, you know, I think Puerto Ricans need a national psychiatrist to deal with this issue of how we deal with both issues at once. I mean, we love the place we were born in. We love the place whose army we served in and we grew up in. I came to New York when I was 7 years old. But I think it's about time that the place I was born in settle the issue of the place I was raised in, solve the issue of the place I was born in. And I think you could go a long way because, Mr. Chairman, you've been a very strong supporter. You've gone a step forward, above and beyond. You've actually asked for statehood for Puerto Rico. But the strongest point you've made is that you want change, dignity, and respect. And I thank you for that, both as an American and as an American who was born in Puerto Rico. And one who lived in Alaska. And by the way, this may be a hearing about Puerto Rico, but you notice it's gotten colder as the hearing went on. That's the influence of the Alaskan chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Hi, thank you, Mr. Arano. Appreciate it. Mr. Garcia, in your testimony, you cite the powers and tools that should be vested with the authority. Focus on the first bullet point in that section of your testimony, implement structural reforms in the government of Puerto Rico and its political subdivision. Why do you feel it's necessary that this is a power of the authority? Is the current or future government of Puerto Rico able to make the necessary structural reforms on its own?
Mr. Chairman, based on my experience during 2009 and 2011, there was always a lot of great political will to be able to go and do the restructuring, but it's always a very hard process to be agreed upon. Lots of analysis, lots of conversations happen, and one of the things that we were not able to achieve on the control board was to be able to effect good reforms in the structure of the government of Puerto Rico. So I think this is a great, unique opportunity based on a federal control board that will be seeking both interests, not only the fiscal but the economic part, to finally be able to analyze the situation and work with the people of Puerto Rico to finally implement a government that will work for its people in a very efficient and agile manner.
Thank you. Mr. Myers, you mentioned the Energy Board has reached a agreement negotiated with the bondholders, is that correct?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Now, why does the legislature have to approve that?
The agreement is structured in a way where the debt moves off the balance sheet of the electric company and onto a special purpose vehicle, which is paid out of a cents per kilowatt hour charge. And that has to be established by legislation, could be established by an authority, but it has to be established by legislation. And the result of this transaction is that the total debt load goes down, the total amount of debt goes down by 15%, the interest rate drops, and there's a five-year holiday on principal repayments. So hundreds of millions of dollars in cash flow are freed up for the electric company to make the investment in natural gas and other plants that need to be made. And this requires the Puerto Rican legislature to change Puerto Rican law so that it all works. Measures have been before the legislature now for probably a month and a half, 2 months, and the deadline for having it passed has already been extended by the bondholders. Every day that goes by without passing this legislation probably costs, in interest rate relief alone, $250,000 a day, because that's the amount of relief that would happen. So that if the legislature passes the law, then this restructuring can go forward. It will save everybody a lot of money, and it will make capital available to PREPA to make the investments that need to be made.
Okay. I'm concerned that energy is what drives the economy. The energy of Puerto Rico is extremely high. That's something we're going to have to address somewhere in this Congress, too, that either you go nuclear, which Puerto Rico's may not want, natural gas can possibly work, infrastructure is extremely expensive. So it's something we're going to have to look at. I'm going to yield to the gentleman, the commissioner, 2 minutes for his time to make a statement or ask a question.
Thank you so much, Chairman. Chairman Young, Chairman Bishop, all of those present at this hearing. I believe that we should put the blame game aside. I believe that we should do all we can to transcend partisan politics. And I believe that we should come up with a legislative package for Puerto Rico that makes sense given the crisis Puerto Rico is facing, given the status of Puerto Rico, and given the reality that this is not a foreign country or foreign nationals. You're talking about American citizens who can hop on a plane from one day to the next if the going is tough down there and nobody can blame them. Now, I can say this with credibility because on the one hand, I represent all of the American citizens living in Puerto Rico in this Congress. In addition, I chair the New Progressive Party of Puerto Rico, the Prostitute Party of Puerto Rico, and I'm running for governor. And yet, I'm saying we need to assist the current administration of Puerto Rico. We need to give the government of Puerto Rico the tools, the necessary tools, to put its fiscal house in order and to, yes, restructure its debts. Now, ideally, we should do that on a negotiated basis, on a consensual basis. But it is not happening. It hasn't happened for too long. So the concept of having a board that would assist Puerto Rico in getting its fiscal house in order and would have a key role in promoting the restructuring and facilitating the debt restructuring makes sense. And to the extent states do not have that tool, I should say, I am the first one who doesn't like the current status of Puerto Rico. But I have to recognize that Congress does have plenary power over the territory of Puerto Rico, and that's why this committee has primary jurisdiction over this issue. So that's the challenge, and Chairman, I believe we can work it out. We can provide Puerto Rico the tools to get back on a path to recovery, get its fiscal house in order, and in the process be fair to creditors, both institutional and individual, including my constituents. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. I can only say that I've listened to Mr. Hirano and yourself and the other witnesses. If we'd done what I said 15 years ago, like we should have, we wouldn't be here today. And I would like to suggest respectfully, we are trying to solve an immediate problem, which is serious, and that doesn't stop me from still pushing statehood. And I know there's no chance can I say hell in this committee? I don't know. No chance in hell of that
say
happening
heck.
Under the present climate. That doesn't preclude this from coming up again if everybody gets their house in order, and that's what we're going to try to do. I want to thank the witnesses. It's one of the best panels I've been able to be chair of. You had good ideas and good thoughts, and with your permission, we'll probably call on you for a little bit of sage advice, as I mentioned before, what will happen if we don't, and we'll do the best we can. With that, if no other comments, this meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.